Thank you so much for such a wonderful welcome. Thank you, Annalise, for having me here, and I'm just excited to meet with you all. I wanted to do an interactive activity before we actually started the discussion. I'm not sure how people usually present to you all, but I want to at least do something so that we can actually experience diversity and inclusion in real time. But because this room is so packed with people, I was going to have people come up to the front of the room. I'm just going to ask you to stay in your seat, and we're going to play a game that I like to call Step to the Line, but because of the way the room is set up, we'll call it Stand Up. So what's going to happen is I'm going to read a series of statements. I'll try to read them as slowly and as clearly as possible. And if the statement applies to you, then I just ask you to stand up for about 3 seconds, allow everyone in the room to take a look at you, and just sit back in your seat. I'm not going to interpret the statement, so just listen to the statements, and if you feel like it applies to you, then you can volunteer to stand up. Everybody get the rules? Everybody ready to play? Yeah, okay, good. Okay. You consider yourself a traditionalist or a baby boomer? Thank you. You consider yourself a Gen Xer or a millennial? Thank you. You are Hispanic, Latino, or of Hispanic descent? Thank you. You have, or a family member has, a visible or hidden disability or mental disability or impairment? Thank you. You have, or a family member has, ever suffered a catastrophic life or life-threatening illness or injury? Thank you. You grew up in a neighborhood that was almost exclusively white. Thank you. Thank you, cameraman. He's participating also. You would consider yourself Jewish. Thank you. You have ever been ashamed of the way that you looked? Thank you. You have ever had to use a personal vacation day or sick day in order to practice your religion or spiritual beliefs? Thank you. You were raised by a single parent, or you have ever been a single parent? Thank you. You could obtain or borrow over $100,000 within 24 hours if an emergency occurred. Thank you. You or someone you know very well is gay, lesbian, bisexual, or transgender. Thank you. You would consider yourself Muslim. You are or have been responsible for the care of elders in your family. Thank you. You are an immigrant to this country. Thank you. You have ever been given a job or a promotion without having to compete for it? Thank you. As a child, you were told not to play with children of a certain race, religion, or ethnic group. Thank you. You assume that people are heterosexual until you find out otherwise. Thank you. You are Asian American, Native Hawaiian, Pacific Islander, or of Asian descent. Thank you. you have felt any form of pressure to be silent on issues of diversity? Thank you. You come from a family where alcohol or drugs was a problem. Thank you. Neither of your parents attended college. Thank you. You're African American, Black, or of African descent. Thank you. You now have or have ever made a primary living by using your hands or doing manual labor. Thank you. You were drafted or enlisted in the armed services or National Guard of any country. Thank you for your service. You have a flexible work schedule that allows you to come and go freely. Nice. Thank you. You have ever withheld telling your manager that you were an expected parent because of fear that it would have negative implications on your performance evaluation or your potential for advancement. You have changed your preferred dress, appearance, speech patterns, or cultural traditions in order to fit in at work. Thank you. You are concerned about how your age will affect your career. Thank you. You or someone in your family has a learning disability. Thank you. You don't have any children. Thank you. You are East Indian, Pakistani, Middle Eastern, or of Middle Eastern descent. You have ever found yourself in the minority in any given location or situation and felt uncomfortable. Thank you. You have ever witnessed verbal or physical abuse of a stranger who was perceived to be gay? Thank you. You have hidden part of your identity in order to fit in or to protect yourself. Thank you. You have ever been the only one of your gender or ethnicity in your peer group or team? Thank you. You would designate your race as other. You are white or Caucasian. Thank you. You would consider yourself as being analytical. Thank you. You would consider yourself as Christian. Thank you. You are Native American, American Indian, Alaskan Native, or Inuit. Thank you. You feel that having children has been or will be a liability to your career. Thank you. You would consider yourself creative. Thank you. And last but not least, you are committed to learning more about diversity and inclusion. Now everybody should stand up. Okay. Thank you. Give yourselves a round of applause. I like to do that activity because I think it really helps us to recognize that there's multidimensional diversity. So when I started working in diversity and inclusion several years ago, we were really having a conversation about race and gender. And over time, the conversation has become so much more complex, and we see how that played out in this room. So can I have a couple of volunteers actually, tell me one word that you felt doing this exercise in front of everyone in the room. You could just raise your hand.
Vulnerable.
Why vulnerable?
Because sometimes you're not sure if you really are comfortable expressing some of the things to others you may not
know. Okay. That's absolutely right.
I felt empowerment.
You felt empowered. Why is that?
Because I knew that I wasn't alone for the people that have certain things that they're part of the same group or they care, you know, things like that.
Okay. So when you stood up and you saw other people standing up, you weren't alone. It felt comfortable, right? Did anybody stand up and was the only person to stand up? Yes, cameraman in the back. Tell me how you felt about being the only person to identify with the statement.
Oh.
Anybody else? Was anybody else the only person to stand up on an issue?
I think I was.
Yeah.
I guess a little bit of discomfort, but also I think my upbringing made me proud to stand up.
Okay, so definitely proud because of the way that your parents made you appreciate your difference, but still you recognize that you were the only one, and so there was a level of discomfort. Thank you. One more person. Please tell me how you felt during doing the exercise. I'm going to do the Socratic method in a second. How did you feel participating in the exercise?
I felt that there's so much diversity in here that I wasn't the only one that was different.
That's right. Thank you. So that's why I like that activity, and give yourselves a round of applause, because it's not easy doing this activity, but I like it because it really helps you understand that most of the diversity that you bring to the table cannot be recognized by the naked eye. So the things that we just learned about each other, we might not necessarily be able to look at a person and see that they're an only child or that they smoke cigarettes or that they know a person who's transgendered, but that came out through conversation and through a willingness to be open. And so that's literally what I'm working towards at the Atlanta Hawks and Phillips Arena in my role. As previously mentioned, I'm the first person to do this job in the MBA, and I'll tell you guys about how it all came about and then what we're doing now. So about 2.5 years ago, almost 2.5 years ago, I was working at Edelman, which is a PR agency, and I was doing diversity and inclusion work there, but I was also doing crisis management. And I got a phone call from one of our crisis clients, and they said, we have a situation. We can't tell you what organization it's with, but all we can tell you about is that it's an issue dealing with diversity and inclusion, race relations, and sports entertainment. Do you think that you can help us? And I said, without knowing a lot about what you're talking about, I think that I can at least try to come to the conversation with some solutions. So I'm willing to come meet you guys at your office. And so I went to Alston & Bird, which is a big law firm in Atlanta, and they had a client there who was sitting there waiting. And his name was Steve Coonan, and he is the CEO of the Atlanta Hawks. And he said, I don't know you, you don't know me, but I have a huge issue and I need some help, and I need more than legal help, I probably need PR. And he began to describe things that were being uncovered in the organization that had taken place over the course of several years. Most of these things were conversations that were happening on email between executives. There were also verbal conversations that were happening in the boardroom during some very important meetings in a public setting. And so what I learned and what we discovered is that the executive team, specifically the ownership team, were not really big fans of their large African-American fan base. They thought that this particular segment of people were loud, rowdy, brought drama and violence to the games, and didn't really make a material impact on the community and in the city. And so they said a lot of different things that came out. One thing that I think people probably saw in the news was an audio recording on a board call of the executive team in which the general manager at the time stated that he didn't want to engage one of the draft picks onto the team, Luol Deng, because he was from Sudan in Africa, and that Africans are used to being very dishonest and disingenuous, and a lot of them sell drugs and do bad things. And so when this all came to light, that these conversations were happening in meetings, the rest of the ownership team said, we've got to do something about this. We have to self-report to the MBA. We've got to address this issue internally, but then we have to be honest with our citizens and our fans and let them know what we found out and figure out a path forward. And so that's at the point where I came into the conversation and I said to, well, the CEO asked me, he said, well, do you think this is going to come out? Do you think that this is ever going to become public? And I told him that what happens in Vegas ends up on YouTube. You can't do anything in the dark nowadays without somebody tape recording, video recording. It's just, we're in a different time. Technology is just too great for anything that happens to remain a secret. And so I told him it wasn't a bad thing. It might be a great thing for the organization. It might be a way for our organization to really take an honest look internally and figure out if there are systems that we should be putting in place or really just thinking about different ways to engage our community so that we don't ever have this happen again. And so after an extensive period of time working with the crisis team, I ended up leaving my job at Edelman and came onto the Hawks as a full-time Chief Diversity and Inclusion Officer. And my first remit was to help build back the city through basketball. So build bridges to the community through basketball. And what did that mean? I didn't know at the time. I literally came into the job with a blank slate of paper and a lot of ideas, but I knew I couldn't do it alone. So the first thing that I did when I started this role was to form a diversity and inclusion council. And the council, I got the idea of starting the council from my days at the NFL. I worked at the National Football League in the league office where Commissioner Goodell sits, and we had a diversity council that I was a part of. And I knew that we did a lot of great work, and I saw a lot of momentum that came out of working with a collective organization focused in this space, but there was something that I thought could be tweaked from the NFL's model. So the NFL's model of the diversity council is just to have all employees from different departments working together simultaneously. What happened in Atlanta with the Atlanta Hawks would not allow for us to make big progress with just working internally, because obviously we had internal issues, right? And so there were a lot of players that were on our not basketball players, but key people and key constituents working in the organization that were not doing the right thing. And so I knew that we had to engage people from the outside, community partners, corporate sponsors, just people that are fans of the game and that come to our games and just want to take part in what we do. So when I started this council, I put together a group of 20 people, 10 internal to the Atlanta Hawks and Phillips Arena across different departments, and then 10 external stakeholders, including ex-professional athletes, clergy, academics, regular fans, small business owners, and the list goes on. And so we came together, and within the first 90 days of forming the council, we decided that we were going to do our work in three different ways. We were going to focus in three areas. The first area that we focus on is internal engagement. And internal engagement is all about the employee experience. It's about how you recruit talent, right? So not just going to traditional sports organizations and looking for people to work in the front office, but really looking more dimensionally at our business and figuring out if we can poach talent from different types of organizations, specifically consulting firms or advertising firms, or just looking outside of sports. And then also looking at multidimensional demographics. So not just getting talent from UGA, even though we love UGA. And Dominique Wilkins is so glad that you all are having this conversation and learning today. But, you know, not just going to one specific type of institution and looking for talent, but really just looking at the way that we bring talent to the organization in a multifaceted way. And then once people get there, right, so once you're able to lure people into the Hawks organization to come in and be a part of our organization, what are we going to do? What mechanisms will we put in place to make sure that every single person can have a unique experience and reach their maximum potential? So like you look at this room, right, and everybody was standing up on different issues and everybody brings something unique to the table. What we're trying to build at the Hawks is an environment where each one of you can really feel comfortable in your own skin, can break down those barriers and be comfortable being the only one to be like you and bring that to the table and have us leverage that as a strength as opposed to looking at you for your difference. So that's our first work stream. Our second work stream is about fan experience. And fan experience is so critically important because fans are what keep us alive. Fans are what keep us going. They're the lifeblood of the city. and of our organization. And so we want to make sure that we're attracting different types of fans. So historically, we have attracted middle-aged men that, you know, live in the suburbs. Those are our season ticket holders, the bulk of who comes to our games regularly, on a regular basis. But we realize that there are so many different emerging groups that are in Atlanta that are starting to flourish and thrive, specifically the Hispanic community and also the LGBTQ community, and we have not done a good job of engaging either. And so Fan Experience thinks about how we can create storylines and how we can create experiences on the court during games so that people of all differences can come to the arena and feel like that really spoke to me tonight. Like, that was so awesome to see the Atlanta Gay Men's Choir singing the halftime show, because that happened a couple of weeks ago. And people wrote us and said, like, that made me happy. Or, you know, having, you know, the first Latino orchestra to come and perform during one of our sets. Like, that's the kind of stuff that we're trying to do, because we want to create experiences that resonate with everybody. So Fan Experience works solely in that space. They also work in the community. So, like, not just what happens at games during game time, but also how we reach out and use our brand to connect with communities outside of our game. So, for instance, we were the first NBA team to march in the Pride Parade. That took place back in October. And not only were we marching in Pride, but we took it a step further. We wanted to create our own float so that it could be unique and that we could really represent our brand and connect with the LGBTQ community. And so we built a nest for Harry the Hawk, our mascot. And it was pretty interesting. We had a great turnout from employees, and the city had a great turnout. So that's a way that we connect with fans as well. And our last work stream is all about strategic partnerships. So strategic partnerships means organizations that we have decided to, for whatever reason, have a long-term investment with in order to work towards a mutually beneficial goal. So usually you see this in the form of corporate sponsorships, like working with Chick-fil-A or working with Bank of America or working with UPS. But we wanted to make sure that we were engaging businesses that were minority-owned and women-owned, right? So not just going to the big companies like Delta Airlines and getting sponsorship dollars, but are we making a difference in communities where women and where minorities own businesses, and how can we leverage them, and how can we utilize some of their products to enhance our brand? And so what we did something phenomenal this summer, which I'm so proud of. So Emory University and the Atlanta Hawks have partnered to build the first sports medicine facility in the NBA. We just broke ground on it several months ago, but it's going to be 90,000 square feet. It's huge. And this is essentially where it's like sports medicine meets the NBA, right? And so we're going to have so many resources for our players, and hopefully, you know, we'll be able to see that this long-term investment can eventually lead us to a championship. But we want to be able to give them the best resources as it relates to sports medicine so that they can reach their maximum potential. And we actually broke ground with H.J. Russell, which is an African-American-owned construction company. So we allowed a lot of different bidders to bid for that business, and we ended up going with them. And that's an example of how strategic partnership and diversity and inclusion works, right? So not just going to those big regular brands, but looking outside of what you traditionally do. So that's how our council works. Our council, we meet quarterly, collectively quarterly, but then our internal members meet monthly. So we don't expect as much hands-on work from our external members. We kind of really use them as a think tank and pick their brains as thought leaders in their respective areas, but we rely on each other internally to get a lot of the hands-on work done, and we've accomplished so many things over a short period of time. Coming up in 2 weeks, our organization has a program that we launched last year, so this will be the second iteration of it, and it's called Mosaic. Mosaic stands for Model of Shaping Atlanta Through Inclusive Conversations. And basically, it's a forum for us to talk about whatever issue is important at the time. Last year, we thought that race and gender in sports was important. And it still is. But we invited our vice chair, Grant Hill, who is one of our owners, to come and talk with his mother, Janet Hill, about the trajectory of their careers in sports. And then we also had representatives from the NCAA, from the NFL, from the NBA, and also the Atlanta Hawks executive teams talking about multidimensional diversity and how they're trying to you know, really make this come to life in their own organizations. And so we did it at the Center for Civil and Human Rights. We thought it was appropriate backdrop, specifically because it was done around Dr. King Day. And so it was definitely the right place for us to have that conversation. But out of that, we learned that having conversations helps our organization to learn. Learn about each other, learn about what's going on in the world around us, and learn how to really solve for issues. And so this past summer, we were met with such an interesting situation. People were protesting in the streets of Atlanta, and you probably saw it all over the news. People were protesting all over the United States, really just upset about what was going on with law enforcement officers and African-American civilians. And the conversation, obviously, in the United States, we didn't have a lot of resolution, and so you saw people really frustrated and angry and walking. And the reason that I bring this up is because they were protesting in front of Phillips Arena. And so as employees of Phillips Arena, we can't ignore the fact that there are other things going on in the world around us. So just, you know, being an MBA team is not enough. We also have to be stewards of the community. It's really part of our job. And so we decided to have an internal conversation with all of our employees at Phillips Arena while this was going on. And it was to acknowledge what was happening. It wasn't to place blame, but it was to really express our concerns and then to collectively come up with an idea for how our organization could at least make the situation better. We didn't ever think that we were going to take on the lofty goal of solving racism because we just know that's too big for the Hawks to solve. But certainly our organization has a large enough platform that we could make a difference in the city and in the community that we reside. And so after about an hour and a half of what I call a very dynamic conversation, we collectively came up with the idea to host what we called Unity Weekend. And Unity Weekend was October 7th through October 10th. And we started with a hands-on activity for our entire organization. So our CEO said, everyone's going to take the day off. No one's coming to work this Friday. We're going to disperse amongst six different community service, community-based organizations in the Atlanta area and give our hands to helping our community. So we went to a homeless shelter. We fed people that are underprivileged. We were able to donate. We throw away so much stuff at the Hawks. I mean, I can't tell you how many T-shirts we get and how, you know, excess basketballs and just closets filled with stuff. And we just took all of that stuff and we gave clothes away and we gave kids balls to play with and said, this is, you know, this is how you give back, right? This is, you know, you don't waste this kind of stuff. You utilize it somehow. So we did 8 hours of service, each person in our company that day. And then we followed that activity by marching in Pride on that Sunday. And then that Monday, it culminated in the first ever Unity game between the Atlanta Hawks and the Cleveland Cavaliers. So, you know, obviously we were excited that the Cavs were willing to join hands with us because they're the NBA champions. But beyond that, we thought that if they could utilize their brand for good and we could utilize ours, we'd love to permeate the NBA and see every team host a Unity Weekend in the next couple of years. And so players, usually what happens during an NBA game is the opposing team gets called and each player goes to the side of the bench where they are going to be sitting, and then the home team gets called and we all go to our side. But during Unity Weekend, we decided to, when the players got called out, they got called one by one. So Cavs, Hawks, and they all ended up forming a line and holding hands while the national anthem was being sung. And we thought that was very powerful. And so those are small things, you know. We're not claiming to be able to have all of the answers and to change the world, but I think that conversations are very critically important. And so that would really be my feedback to you all. I know that you all are very new in this space as an institution, and you're delving into deep issues about diversity and equity and inclusion and probably looking at a lot of it from a theoretical perspective, but I would encourage you guys to be very practical about it as well. And you know, form your own council or form, you know, different groups that are tackling different issues. So figure out what are the main issues that you guys want to tackle here, and then how can you guys collectively put your heads together? Because I think it's impossible to boil the ocean. It's impossible to make all of these things go away. But I think little by little, you'd be surprised how much progress you can make in a short period of time. So that is what I wanted to talk about with you all, but I really wanted to open this up for Q&A because I feel like you can probably learn a lot more by asking me what's on your mind and then having us just chat through it. So thank you for listening and for participating. And now I want to open it up for Q&A.
Do you guys have to talk about the women's matches
That's such a good question. So in terms of the women's marches, so we started a group inside of the Hawks called Hawks WIN, W-I-N, and it stands for Women's Inclusion Network. And so we have a group of people inside of our company, and they're not only women that are a part of WIN, they're actually men that are also a part of it that care about women's issues. And so some of us participated in the march. We weren't required to, but if people felt compelled and that they wanted to be a part of that, we encourage them to do that. And so there were members of Hawks WIN out there with their Hawks gear on. And that's the thing. Like, I think with diversity and inclusion, you don't want to alienate anybody and make people feel like they have to or they don't have to participate in things. But I think by opening up these conversations, we allow people to express what they're interested in. And so, yes, we have a lot of women that were a part of that. Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. People, when I first started my job, there were a lot of naysayers. There were people that were, you know, I was on a lot of radio interviews defending my position and really talking about what could be accomplished because there were people out there that were like saying, well, is that a real job or is it just in reaction to the fact that they were just in the news? So is it just window dressing to mask a problem but not really address it wholeheartedly? And so through my work and through the work with the council, I think that the way that we've been able to address naysayers is to have small wins, which increase to larger wins. There's no way that I'm ever going to convince everybody that this work is important. No, everybody's not going to be on the same page about what we can accomplish. But as long as I know what I have to do and as long as that I truly believe in my heart that diversity and inclusion is what makes the world go round, what people thrive off of, that's my North Pole and my guiding light. And so I conduct myself like that every day. I mean, even me coming here, I drove here from Atlanta. I loved the drive to Athens, by the way. It was fun. It was nice. But yeah, this is the work that I have to do, and this is the work that we all have to do. So whether or not there are naysayers, we kind of have to shut that out in order to get things done. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
That's such a great question. I wish we had more resource behind it. I wouldn't say no. I wouldn't say yes either. So here's the truth of the matter. The truth of the matter is I'm a very small department. I'm the first one. I'm not the only one. So since I was hired, the MBA hired a chief diversity officer 6 months later. And then the Cavs, the Nets, and the Suns have one now. So we're starting to see teams take this role on. But they're such small departments. And so what I would say, my advice for somebody that would be interested in this work in a sports environment would be to, if there isn't a traditional diversity internship available, try to get an internship in the organization and then figure out what their diversity challenges are and then make a proposal for how you can infuse diversity into the organization, right? So you're definitely not going to be able to go to a company and start in a full-fledged diversity role in sports. It's something that's very new and still trending and on a trajectory, but that would not prevent you from starting it yourself or from at least starting the conversation.
It sounds like y'all like obviously have a good idea of how to promote diversity in a good manner and stuff. How, like, have any other organizations, like maybe the Falcons or other, I know you talk about other NBA teams mm-hmm. getting their deal, or not even sports teams, that's really, has anyone else gone to you for help on how to, especially in today's time?
Yeah, I get a lot of phone calls from different organizations, but you'd be surprised, a lot of the big corporate organizations have a diversity officer. So like Coca-Cola, I talk to their chief diversity officer all the time. We actually did a program with Coke recently. Andrew Davis is his name. You know, SunTrust Bank, Wendy McSweeney is her name. She's the chief diversity officer there. There's big companies have diversity officers. They have to because they manage so many people. When you start looking at smaller organizations like sports or like the Hawks, we have 250 employees. So big brand, but small in terms of execution. We have to talk to other people. We have to talk to other diversity officers to learn about the best, like use best practices and learn the best things to do. I'm just trying to think about how to answer your question. Yeah, because I do think that the big companies are doing it right, and I do think they have formal programs set up, but in terms of smaller companies, not so formal. So a lot of it is just information sharing and networking.
So this is a little bit more of a more recent question, but how do you deal with, like, setbacks with, like, I know there were comments made by Wilcox, I believe. so how do you, like, I know you've talked about all this progress, but when something like that comes up, how do you kind of start again and keep moving forward?
Yeah, that was such a frustrating situation. Thank you for bringing it up. So we recently, so I was on maternity leave until like January. And during December, I get a phone call from my boss and he's like, oh, I know you're not working, but I need you to work. I'm like, okay, what happened? And so we found out that there was an employee chalk talk with our general manager, and it actually was with season ticket holders. So there were two different chalk talks, but this one in particular was with season ticket holders. And so essentially a chalk talk is like a forum like this where there's a bunch of people in the room and then you get to ask the general manager questions. And so the general manager was having a debate and a dialogue with one of our season ticket holders. And he referenced his wife. He's a Caucasian man, but he referenced that his wife is African American, and so he's used to dealing with angry people, and he knows how to handle that. And so that offended some African American people in the room. And then we got a bunch of phone calls, and it was like, oh, the Hawks are at it again. You're back to square one. And it was really frustrating for somebody like me because we came out of that 2 years ago. And so to do all of this work and to set up the Mosaic program and to be at Pride and to be, you know, connecting with the Hispanic community in an organic way and then get back to this place where everyone's like, well, what the hell are you guys doing? This is still going on. It was very frustrating. And it was a reminder that we cannot keep our foot off of the pulse, right? We can't get so comfortable and you can't set up these programs as mirrors or, you know, window dressing. Like, you have to set up these programs with the intention of making them sustainable, real, and lasting over time, or else you could literally, like, that quickly be right back to square one. So, frustrating, but we're getting our way through it.
Curious of the impact you've seen through the work of your office and everything on the players. Have you noticed any positive change with them and even their interest and commitment to the team?
Yep. That's such a great question because a lot of times, like, there's such a disconnect between what happens in an organization versus what happens on the court, right? So players are part of basketball operations and they do something very specific. And then we're corporate executives and we do something very different for the organization. But we have been able to connect with players very well on issues of diversity and inclusion. And as a matter of fact, a lot of them have foundations where they have even donated money to some of our causes and donated resources to kids that we're trying to help. So, for instance, we partnered, the NBA is a champion for the My Brother's Keeper initiative, which was established by Barack Obama about 3.5 years ago. And My Brother's Keeper is a platform that President Obama implemented across the whole entire United States. He implemented chapters to help young men that are between the ages of 11 and 17 and at risk for being in the juvenile justice system. And so My Brother's Keeper is essentially ways for communities to come in and be mentors and to offer resources and give advice to these young boys to get them back on a good path. And so the Hawks decided to host a My Brother's Keeper chapter of Fulton County in our arena. So we brought 150 boys from Fulton County that are at risk. And we brought them to the arena, not only to participate and attend a game, a lot of them have never been to an NBA game, but that entire day they had conversations with law enforcement officers to try to break down barriers between those that disconnect that's going on. They were paired with mentors from the 100 Black Men of America, And then Paul Millsap, who happens to be our only all-star player this year, number 4, go Paul. He and his foundation donated $10,000 to the young boys so that they could have money for school supplies and clothing and things of that nature. But they didn't just get those things. They had to do an oratorical contest in which we asked each boy to write, I think it was like write an essay about like your life or what you feel. Like, you know, it wasn't anything that was so rigorous, but it was really giving them an opportunity to be expressive. And then we ended up giving like the top 4 essays because, you know, you had to put effort into it. You have to work for these things, right? We're trying to instill those lessons as well. But we ended up giving financial resources to them through Paul. So that's one way players get involved in our diversity and inclusion efforts. We have another way. Tabo Cephalosha, who happens to be another great player on our team, he is of Swiss, well, so he's of Swiss descent, kind of, I think. So his parents are South African, but then he grew up in Switzerland. So he's very like multicultural and international and multidimensional. I think one of his parents is European and the other one is African descent. And then he, you know, so he brings that multidimensional diversity to the table. But then he was just in a situation in New York last summer where he was actually physically attacked by a police officer. And so he is going to participate in 2 weeks on March the 14th at our next Mosaic program because our topic this year, so I told you guys last year was race and gender in sports. This year is sports as a catalyst for social action. And so he's going to talk about how he utilized his platform to be, you know, vocal about the issues and to actually work with law enforcement and work with civic leaders to enact change in different communities. So he had to go through something bad, but he's getting to a good place. So yeah, I mean, our players getting involved, you know, their schedules are very limited, as you can imagine. They're on a tight schedule. Like in the next 12 days, we have 8 games. So that just goes to, I mean, these guys are on a plane, off a plane, practicing, doing a lot. So we try to engage them as much as we can. But we leverage the community. I mean, we use our brand and we realize that we are not only about our players. We're about everyone in the community.
You talked a lot about like engagement and how you're trying to engage the community to kind of build that rapport with each other. So my question is more so, has there been any like engagement as far as the local colleges and universities that's in Atlanta? And like how have those relationships been if they have been made?
Yeah, definitely. So we engage with all the local schools, Emory, Georgia State, Georgia Tech, Spelman Morehouse, Clark Atlanta University, and the list goes on, specifically as it relates to getting junior talent into our building. So we reach out to them for mostly opportunities that are in-house. I don't know if you're talking about basketball opportunities, but I'm talking about like corporate opportunities. Yeah, because that's who we want to engage and attract first. Of course, we were open to institutions that are across the board and across different states, but if you can't take care of your immediate community, how can you take care of others, right? And then we've also partnered with the city of Atlanta to infuse the game of basketball back into the city through renovating neighborhood courts. So 2 years ago, like we went around Atlanta and we recognized that there were all these public basketball courts, but they were just broken down, like no netting on the rims and broken concrete, dangerous, like not good at all. And we were like, how can we utilize our strength in the community to bring back the game of basketball to Atlanta? And so we partnered with a company called CBA Sports, and they are the number one organization to make all types of sports courts. So they do like volleyball courts, basketball courts, football, turf, everything sports related. And so the Atlanta Hawks Foundation has given a set amount of number to CBA Sports to renovate 25 courts throughout the city. So we've been doing unveils, I'd say like every 2 months. So right now we have 7 courts that have been renovated with about 13 more to go. And it's just been amazing. Like we've just seen we've seen kids that were, you know, doing crime and like into drugs and whatever was going on in those communities. They're starting to now focus their energy and attention into basketball because these courts are gorgeous. I wish I brought pictures, but you can look them up on Hawks.com. If you look in our community section, you'll see our basketball builds. We're starting to see less crime in those areas. The mayor just made a public announcement about how the neighborhoods are starting to flourish now because people are now doing something productive, right? There's something to concentrate on. And so that's how we want to connect basketball to our city through community. It's so important. I mean, I grew up in New York, and so I remember just being like a kid, and we would just go to basketball courts, and they weren't fancy like the ones that we're doing now, but like we would have tournaments and the Rucker, and just people would play ball all day, and it was great because it promoted wellness and it promoted team ball and just, you know, collegial working together, right? And so why can't we do that in Atlanta? I mean, we've got more courts than we had in New York City, so there's no way and no reason that we shouldn't be able to connect that way.
There are multitudes of benefits that you talked about, like building community, and but I'm wondering, I'm a department head, and so I always look at the finances.
Sure.
So have you had to justify what you're doing from a financial perspective?
Oh, yeah.
Like,
yeah, they don't just give me the money.
Right. So how does that translate? Because I think that trying to promote something like you're doing with other organizations, the people who want to know how will it help the bottom line.
Yeah. So a lot of it is a bottom line issue.
Yeah.
But what I talk about to my CEO and my CFO all the time is that there are some investments that just need to be made. So like I'm not on the sales team. There's no way that I'm ever going to be a revenue generator in the way that they can. But the material benefits and gains that we get long term, to me, are impacting the bottom line. So for instance, if I'm reaching out to a new demographic like LGBTQ, that demographic research has shown that they happen to have access to discretionary spending. A lot of them are not parents, and so there's a little bit of extra cushion in the budget, and they really want to connect to something fun, right? So, like, if we can reach out to that community and make them really feel a part of what we're doing, then perhaps they'll become season ticket holders in the long term and want to come to Hawks games. That's not why we do it, but it's one of the things that you can look back as a metric and say, participating in Pride, we have a new demographic of people that are now attending games and we see an uptick in sales. I don't really like to think about it that way, though. I think that at a certain point when you're doing this work, it's got to be organic. And it's going to cost. I always tell people, diversity is not free. It's not. It costs money. Like, just to put T-shirts on these kids that we're trying to engage with or buy basketballs for them. Like, that's why a lot of the money that we fundraise goes to our foundation, which is a 501c3 and eventually helps us to make an impact in the community. But we're not going to ever be a big revenue generating department.
My question kind of goes off of that. You know, we've got faculty, staff, and students in the room, students, grad students, undergrad students. But I was curious what you think in this current socio-political cultural time. I think someone asked about the marches, but I'm curious about what you think we should be doing, considering what's going on in our world.
Like, you got you?
Yeah. How, quote-unquote, divided our nation is right now. I mean, there are all these kind of narratives going on right
yeah.
now about diversity at a larger level.
No, you're right. I think that what you guys can do, I am such a big proponent of conversation. I think that you need to get in the community and have hosts. Think about 10 different topics that matter right now, or 5, whatever. And think about people in this room that are thought leaders in each of the different spaces, right? Perhaps you can have somebody host a chalk talk with the community, right? So UGA hosts diversity, equity, and inclusion chalk talk on issues of equity in college athletic sports. I'm making it up off the top of my head. But whatever the topics are that you guys deem collectively, right? So you collectively need to have a conversation first. What's important? What are the top 5 things that we need to help solve for? And then once you decide what those are, divvy yourselves up and then do the work to, like, get out in the community. Get on social media. Like, these young kids are all over Twitter, Instagram. Like, utilize those platforms to say, like, UGA wants to have a tweet up and we're going to host it in our school, offer them free coffee or whatever. Like, I used to do tweet ups when I was at Edelman, and I would offer, like, alcohol. Free wine, and then everyone would show up like, we're here for the wine. But by the end of the conversation, they were like, wow, I learned something. you know? So whatever it takes to entice people to get to these, I mean, you guys have the perfect backdrop. You're an academic institution with like all of these different brains and all of this mental agility going on. Like, you should lead in this space in that way. It looks like time is winding down. I have time for one more question. And then obviously I'll stay after if anyone wants to get me one-on-one. But is there one more question from the group?
No question. Given that our perception of social reality will impact the cultural background, So how do we go about having a conversation to accept different dialects, cultural backgrounds we come to work in one space?
That's such a good question. If you guys didn't hear her, she basically said that we have so many different, the way that you perceive people is very culturally based, right? And so if, you know, someone's got an accent or someone looks a little bit different or someone brings something unique to the table, how can we let down our guard to have conversations to bridge that gap? And I think that... I think the first step is acknowledgement, right? A lot of times we don't acknowledge the truth. So we say things like, oh, my best friend is black. Or we say things like, oh, I don't see color. It's like, well, are you do see color, right? So we have to be honest, like, it's okay if your best friend is black. You don't have to say that. You can just say, I have a best friend, right? You don't have to put a descriptor around them. And so I think acknowledgement is the first part before we have to be honest about what we know. We have to be honest about what we don't know. A lot of times we assume things and don't ask questions. I used to take colleagues to coffee randomly based on something that I would want to know about them. So say, for instance, you looked interesting to me at work, but I didn't really know you weren't in my department. I would ask you to coffee and I would have just ask you questions about yourself. And I ended up learning a lot about people along the way. And then what I realized is that people like to talk about themselves. They really do. They want to tell you all of these things that have happened in their life. And not that you don't have to delve into each other's personal lives and tell each other your deep, dark secrets. But even if it's something as simple as, I see you wear eyeglasses and I wear eyeglasses and they tell me I'm farsighted. Are you farsighted or nearsighted? And you'd be surprised where that conversation will go. Right? So I think that in the context of your question, I think that people need to acknowledge that there are differences, embrace the differences, and then perhaps figure out ways to leverage each other's differences. So you might offer something that she doesn't offer, but she may offer something that you don't. So if you guys were a team, then your part would be covered and her part would be covered. So it would be a stronger team than if you were working alone, right? So like, try to figure out like, what is someone's strength that I can leverage in the grand scheme of what we're trying to accomplish? But you have to acknowledge the differences. Yeah.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.